Hey everybody, how you doing today? Good, I'm really glad to be back with you. I do not like being on the screen like last week. It's a really long story how all that happened, but for the two or three people who have asked, no, we're not planning to go back to that. I don't plan on being up there very often. I plan on being right here for the foreseeable future, and grateful to be into God's Word with you today. Hopefully you can grab a copy of your copy of God's Word. 1 Peter 3 is where we're going to be today. I've been spending a whole lot of time lately. This is a little bit of true confessions in church. I've been spending probably too much time watching sports lately. You know, we're getting like dangerously close to the finals. I'm talking about a real sport, not basketball. Hockey, of course, is what I'm talking about. But it's like every night there's been great hockey on, and yes, some people are playing some basketball as well. But it's one of those things. There's like the highs and the lows. You see the people who are so excited and have such elation for what they've accomplished, and then also the other people nearly sobbing for what they were so close to experiencing. And each time they do an interview with the people who make it on to the next round, you know, what always comes about is like, how did you get here? What brought you to this point? And every one of the people who are interviewed will always point back to some of the training that they did. They'll mention the preseason. You know, it started, we worked really hard, and they talk about the weights and the times that they were in the weight training room, the times that they were doing sprints, the long practices, all of the things that happened way, way, way before the season ever began, all of those difficult things that they got through, all of that helped them get to accomplish the victory. And most of what we see in life, it's not the victory. Most of what we see in life isn't the celebration. It's not even the joyous time that we would look back and see what we've accomplished. Most of life is the training. Most of life is the difficult days in the weight room. It's those doing those sprints when we don't feel like it. Most of life is that difficulty, and we have an issue lots of times when we experience and believe that our experience should be all that of happiness. It should just be the victory. It should just be the fun things. It shouldn't be any of the training, but most of life is, in fact, that training. C.S. Lewis actually said, if you think of this world as a place simply intended for our happiness, you will find it quite intolerable. But if you think of it as a place for training and correction, it's not so bad. And I think that reorienting of our lives, of our thinking, to see life as training, as actually a difficult time, a time when we're growing and learning and being stretched and trusting the Lord in greater ways, not yet seeing all of the victory that we're going to experience in Jesus Christ, the victory that He's already accomplished for us, but we're not yet seeing. But right now, in the middle of it, we're in the midst of that training. And we're looking at 1 Peter over and over. He's bringing us back to that, telling us that we're going to experience hardships and suffering and persecution and the difficult things of this life. And it doesn't really take us long to look at our own lives and see some of that suffering, some of that pain that we feel, some of the training that we're going through right now, so that we could experience the victory. 1 Peter 3, 18 through 22 is where we're going to be at today for our spiritual food. And Peter's point in all of this is that we shouldn't be surprised by the suffering that we have to endure. That Jesus himself experienced a temporary suffering to receive an incredible reward for us. We should expect the same. That we'll experience suffering in this life and temporary difficulties in the midst of our training. But there is a day coming when we will receive that reward, our eternal inheritance that's secure and that's awaiting us. But before we look at God's Word, let's take a moment and pray again. Father, we are thankful for your word and thankful for a time when we can be together looking into it. Thank you for the words that Peter has written, for the way that your Holy Spirit has breathed out these words to us. And Lord, we would pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would open the eyes of our hearts and our minds to receive what you would have for us today. Would you work in us, encourage us, and challenge us for your good purposes here on this earth as we await your victory that's coming soon, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we're looking at these passages. What exactly does Jesus accomplish for us in the midst of this suffering? While we're going through all of these difficulties, while we're going through the challenges that we experience, what comfort can we receive? When we're persecuted, when we're maligned for our faith, is there any hope that we can then experience now? Jesus accomplished this victory for us. And 1 Peter 3:18 and following shows us three actions that Jesus accomplished, three actions of Jesus that speak to us as we wait to see his victory fully here on earth. First, he brought us to God. Second, he called for repentance. And third, he subjected the powers. Let's start reading in verse 18 and first look at he brought us to God. Jesus brought us to God. Verse 18 says, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. For being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit." Peter begins this paragraph here with the word "for." He's pointing back to what we've talked about in weeks previously. Our passage today, it helps us explain and understand what comes right before us. And while this passage, I just want to give you a warning shot across the bow as we're beginning, it's a little bit of a tricky one. I've spent a lot of time wrestling with this, and a lot of commentators say different things about what they believe that this passage means. But while it's a bit of a tricky one, anytime you come to a passage in God's Word and you're like, what in the world does that mean? Do you ever have that? Well, I hope it's a little bit of a comfort that I have that from time to time. And when you come to a passage and you're like, what exactly does that mean? What did Peter mean when he was writing that? Anytime you come to a difficult passage, one of the most helpful things you can do is look at the context. Look, what is he saying right before this and right after that? And it will help us understand what the author is saying. So let's remind ourselves a little bit of what Peter's been saying. Back, if you look back up just a little bit, 1 Peter 3, 14 through 17, he's telling the believers there, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you'll be blessed. Have no fear of them, the people who are causing you to suffer, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. See, Peter's readers, they're a bit in the crosshairs, the firing line. They're being slandered, they're being persecuted because of their Christian commitments, because they follow Jesus. And Peter's telling them, don't have any fear in the midst of it. Yes, it's going to be difficult, but be ready to give a defense for that and have no fear. That's what he's telling them right before this passage. And so right as we move into this, keep all of that in mind. And he begins by saying, the righteous for the unrighteous. As he's talking about Jesus here, Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous. Jesus, he was in the same boat as the people in Peter's day, as we are so often, that we're suffering for righteousness' sake, that people around us might think ill of us or speak ill of us or treat us poorly because of the fact that we follow Jesus Christ, because of the fact that we think differently than so many do in this strange land. And it's saying that he, the righteous one, Jesus Christ, for the unrighteous, for us, the righteous people. The righteous one, Jesus, was given for the unrighteous people, me and you. And he's done that so that he might bring us to God, it says. The reason that Jesus was willing to suffer was so that you and I would be brought to God. It wasn't for his own sake, it was for us. He came to seek and to save the lost. He came to serve and to give himself as a ransom for many. The reason Jesus sacrificed himself, the reason that he suffered, was so that you and I would be brought close to God. And if he had not come and suffered, then we would not have been brought close to God. It's like so many have this goal of climbing Mount Everest, and when they go, they hire a Sherpa, a person who will hike with them to the top of Everest, because they're not able to do that on their own without a guide. Now, these people could go up and down all day to Everest. They're familiar with it, but their whole job is to make a hard climb so that others can come along. And that's what Jesus does. He suffers for us so that we will be brought close to God. He suffered in ways perfectly that we were unable to. He died as a substitutionary atonement. Those are big words, but it really means that Jesus died in my place. That when he came and he suffered on this earth and was put to death on a cross and was murdered there, even as he was innocent, that he did that in your place and in my place so that we could be brought close to God. 2 Corinthians 5:21 is one of my favorite verses. It says, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin." Jesus Christ, perfect, without sin. "But he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." That Jesus took my sin upon him. He took your sin upon him. And he died on the cross in your place and in my place, so that we might receive his righteousness, the righteous one for the unrighteous people, that righteous, perfect Son of God, Jesus Christ, for an unrighteous Jeff Thompson. Jesus died in our place to bring us to God. And this reality of bringing us to God is the ultimate reality of heavenly rewards that are awaiting us. We treasure so often what is awaiting us in that eternal secured inheritance for us. And we would stand and sing just a moment ago in the song Hymn of Heaven, and we were reminded of the fact that he will wipe away tears, that there will be no more death or pain or sadness or sickness or heartache or strife between people. Don't you long for those things? And those are beautiful things for us to long for, but don't miss this, believer. More than anything else, the thing that is waiting you is Jesus Christ himself. It's a relationship with him, because the beautiful thing about that song again is it says standing face to face with our Savior Jesus Christ. If you can get heaven without God, you'll miss all of it anyway. If all you're doing is waiting for that time when the suffering will be over, it will be over. But if that is your ultimate reward, if that is the thing that you are waiting for more than anything else, you'll miss out on all of it. The thing that we are longing for and waiting for and need more than anything else is God himself, to be with Jesus Christ for all eternity. John Piper, I want to read this quote in God is the Gospel. He says, "The critical question for our generation and for every generation is this. If you could have heaven with no sickness, with all the friends you ever had on earth, with all the food you ever liked, and all the leisure activities you ever enjoyed, and all the natural beauties you ever saw, and all the physical pleasures you ever tasted, and no human conflict, natural disasters, could you be satisfied with heaven if Christ was not there? Could you be satisfied with heaven if Christ was not there. Christ did not die to forgive sinners who go on treasuring anything above seeing and savoring God. And people who would be happy in heaven if Jesus Christ was not there will not be there at all. The gospel is not a way to get people to heaven. It's a way to get people to God. Jesus died in your place so that you would be brought to God. Because there was a gap between us and God that we created with our sin, that we broke a relationship that was there. And we were enemies of God, and he brought us near more than anything else. It's that reality of standing face to face with Jesus Christ, our Savior. Do you love him more than all else? If he never answered a single one of your prayers for suffering to cease or for things to be answered in your life, would you still treasure him as Savior and Lord? Because that's what he does for us. He dies to bring us near to him. How do I know if God alone is my goal? Well, when I lose comforts, when I lose the pleasurable things, when I lose the things in life that I'm hoping for, am I angry with the Lord? Do I curse the Lord because you wouldn't give me what I wanted? Or is it enough to just have him? Is he your treasure more than anything else? Because he died to bring us to God. He brought us to God, and secondly, he called for repentance. He called for repentance. Let's begin reading. I want to read from the beginning again, 18 all the way to 20. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through water. Jesus called for repentance. He says here that there was death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, that there's a fleshly realm and there's an appropriate spiritual realm then. It says here, and this is the part of the passage, I just want to be super clear, this is the part of the passage that's really unclear for a lot of us, that seems difficult. What does it mean when he says he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison? See that it says that, verse 19, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison. So I'm going to do something here that you're not really supposed to do in preaching, but it is a very confusing passage, so I just want to do this anyway. Fair? Good? Okay, I'm going to break some rules here. So I'm going to give you three options. Typically what they say is whenever you come to a very difficult one, just preach the one that you really believe is the best, and I'm going to do that in a minute, but I want to give you a couple of options. These are some of the things that people believe. So first option is that maybe it's that Jesus went and he preached to the people in the Old Testament who died. So they died. So during Jesus's, in between when Jesus was killed on the cross and when he was raised again, maybe it's that he went and he preached the gospel to the people in the Old Testament who had not yet heard the gospel. The problem is that isn't anywhere in God's word, and the problem is it gives it's what we would call a second chance theology, that the people who've heard about God, who were told all of God's promises, they didn't know about Jesus Christ, but they knew about the promise of a Messiah, that God said very beginning, all the way back in Genesis 3, he said, I'm going to take care of your sin. I promise that I will. And he continues to make those promises. And God's people throughout the century, even before Jesus came, they were looking forward to the promise of their salvation that was promised to them. In the same way that we look back to the promise that has been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Hebrews 9:27 says that it's appointed once to die, and after that comes judgment. This life is the only opportunity you get to follow Jesus Christ. You're hearing the message of the gospel. And the people in the Old Testament heard the message of God's provision for their sin, that faith in him is the thing that produces salvation for them. They heard that message, and they either accepted that message or denied it. It's appointed once to die, and after that comes judgment. I don't believe that this is a viable option with all that we see in God's word. A second option is that some people believe that Jesus proclaimed victory over the evil angels who married human women in Genesis 1 through 4. Now, this seems a little confusing for us. If you go back to Genesis 6 at one point, this is where you see the Nephilim, and what it says in that passage is that fallen angels, evil angels, came down and married women. And so the view here by some that I believe are wrong is that Jesus then, during that time, between when he died on the cross and when he was raised on Easter Sunday, that he went and proclaimed victory over those evil spirits. I don't think this makes a lot of sense based on, again, the context that's there. Okay, so I'm done with all of the really confusing part. Can I tell you what I really believe that this means? Great, yeah. Some people said, please, yeah. That's why we don't like to do that sort of thing. But I wanted to be clear with, like, there is a little bit of disagreement on what those couple of words mean. I believe that what this means is that Jesus, in spirit, was preaching through Noah when Noah was telling people about the coming judgment. If you remember back in Genesis, Noah's building an ark. There's a judgment coming. And as he's building this ark, he's preaching to the people there, and many of them, most of them, reject the Lord. And I think what this is saying is that when Noah was preaching, when he was proclaiming God's provision and God's coming judgment, that Jesus was preaching through him. And I think that what this is talking about here, a lot of people get confused by the spirits in prison. I believe these are people who were alive during Noah's time, but since have sadly rejected God's message and died, and now sadly are spirits in prison. It's like saying the people in Cook County Jail have committed crimes. Now, that doesn't mean that they committed crimes while they were in Cook County Jail. It means they committed crimes and now they're in Cook County Jail. And I think that's what it's saying here. The spirits, they're spirits in prison now. They used to be people on earth in Noah's time, and he was proclaiming the message, repent, turn away from your sins and turn to the Lord who's providing a way of salvation. And they rejected that, sadly. And they ended up being spirits in prison, where all who will reject God's message end up. They had an opportunity to repent, to turn, and throughout history, even before Jesus came to earth, this message of repentance was proclaimed. And Peter here is saying Jesus was calling for their repentance even back then, but they didn't turn from their sins. They didn't trust the Lord. And so now they're spirits in prison. And Peter's telling us this when we're in the midst of a culture, when his readers are in the midst of a culture that are turning away from that message of repentance. He just told us to be ready to give a defense, but in the midst of that, even as you give a defense, people are going to slander you, they're going to malign you and persecute you. They're going to turn away from the message of repentance. It's in that vein that Peter's telling all this. I think it's very in keeping with other things Peter will say. He said back in 1 Peter 1:11, Peter says that the Spirit of Christ was active in the proclamation that was done by the prophets. So here he's saying that Jesus is preaching through Noah. He already told us that Jesus was preaching through the prophets. Later in his next letter, 2 Peter 2:5, Peter is going to call Noah a herald of righteousness, a preacher of righteousness. And so I think Peter's point in all of this is Jesus calls people to repentance. He came to seek and to save the lost. That happened while he was here on earth. But Peter's saying that it happened even before he was born as a baby in Bethlehem. And I think Peter is saying it's still happening today. Jesus is still seeking and saving the lost. He's still crying out, calling for a repentance. Repentance means to turn from your sins and to trust the promise of salvation that's found in Jesus Christ alone. That's what Peter is calling us to. Just as he spoke through Noah to a wicked generation, just as he spoke through the prophets to their world, now he's chosen to speak through you and through me. We're his ambassadors. You are his mouthpiece. Jesus preaches through you when you are ready to give a defense for the hope that is in you. He's still calling people to repentance. God's patience, just as it was then, we see it in the text, God's patience is still waiting, even now. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. It's a message of repentance for some here today, that if you have yet to turn from your sins and trust Jesus Christ by faith for salvation, the message from God's word is repent. The message from Jesus himself is repent. Turn from those things and trust Jesus Christ, because his patience, it's here today. There's an opportunity to receive him, but his patience won't always be there. It's appointed once for us to die, and then comes judgment. And I don't know what that day is for you. I don't know if it's today or tomorrow or next week, or if you have 10 more years or another 50 years. We don't know, but his patience is for today, so repent, because he's calling people to repentance. Peter here, he's using Noah as an example because of the similarities between the culture in Noah's time and the culture at Peter's time, and I would say the culture in our time, in our day. A minority of faithful believers surrounded by a wicked world. A culture that at best is apathetic to the message and indifferent to God's message, and at worst, it's hostile and antagonistic towards it. A small group of believers who are called to proclaim, to preach that message of salvation and forgiveness that's granted upon repentance and believe upon the Lord. Listen, there's heartache for those who would refuse to repent because of a knowledge of the coming judgment. We know that that is coming, and it's sad to hear the spirits who are in prison and many more who will be spirits in prison because they will choose to reject Jesus Christ. But it's a message for you and I today that there is a judgment coming, and he's calling us to be his mouthpiece, to preach as Jesus does to a world that's around us. The message for you and I is that God's judgment is coming, but he will bring us safely through. Just as he brought the eight persons, Noah and his family, come into the ark, and they're taken safely through God's judgment. They're provided for, and the message of the rainbow and the sky is a reminder that God keeps his promises to his people, and he brings them through. So when you are making a defense, you can take comfort that you're simply communicating the same words of Jesus Christ. That when people do malign you, when people do persecute you or speak badly of you because of what you're communicating, you're preaching Jesus Christ. You're preaching a message of repentance, calling people to repent, to turn from their sins, and to turn to Jesus Christ for salvation. Jesus preaches, he called for repentance. And third and finally, he subjected the powers. He subjected the powers. Verse 21 and 22, then, as we finish our passage today, verse 21 says, baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who's gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels and authorities and powers being subjected to him. He subjected the powers. Peter here uses baptism as another example. He brings Jesus's death on the cross and his resurrection as an example. He brings Noah and the flood as an example. And now he brings baptism as an example. And he says it corresponds to this. He's giving us an example. People being saved in the ark is just like people being saved in Christ, is what Peter is saying here. The flood was a judgment of God upon all humanity, and only those who entered the ark by faith, believing in God's promise that he would provide for them, only those who believed in his promise were saved from destruction. And likewise, judgment is coming on all of the world, and only those who enter Jesus Christ by faith will be saved from that destruction. Only those who believe God's promise that he's providing a way in Jesus Christ. In Noah's day, only 8 were saved. In Peter's day, only a few were saved. And even today, it is still a narrow road. But Peter here, he's explaining baptism along these same lines. It's why often when we talk about baptism, we practice baptism by immersion in the same way that they did in Peter's time. And we do that because it is a picture of dying to Jesus Christ, being buried with him, and raised in newness of life. So just as we stand in the tank, right over here, there's still a water stain from where it leaked. It's just as we stand here, right about here in the tank, and a person goes under the water, it's dying to myself, dying to my sin, dying to death itself, being buried with Jesus Christ and then raised to new life. Baptism is a picture of an internal reality that's happening. He says it's not a removal of dirt from the body. You're not taking a bath up here. He means that the physical act of baptism isn't actually what saves you. It's not like going under the water is actually the thing that saved you. There's nothing magical about the water. We don't do anything to it. Elvin, our head deacon, fills it up and heats the water so it's not like ice cold, because it comes out of a garden hose. I mean, there's nothing special about the actual water. It's an external picture of an internal reality. It's what it points to. It's not removing dirt from you. It's not like taking a bath. He's talking about the reality that happens in our heart. What's significant isn't the actual water. What's significant is what it points to. Peter here, what does he call it? He calls it an appeal to God. It's another way of saying that you're asking the Lord to forgive you of your sins because of Jesus's payment for you. You're asking God to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you in Jesus Christ. Again, it's an external picture of an internal reality. This is why we believe in believer's baptism. It's a decision that we make as followers of Jesus Christ. It's why we don't baptize babies, because we don't see that in God's word. We see believers repenting, turning from their sins, trusting Jesus Christ by faith, and then getting baptized. The New Testament knows nothing of an unbaptized believer. It's what believers do. It's not that baptism saves you, but it's what saved people do. We get baptized to show this external picture of an internal reality that's happened before. It should come when a person makes a decision for themselves, an appeal to God, as Peter says it here. We're appealing to God for salvation. If you have not been baptized as a believer, we would love to help you do that. Elvin would love to put the baptism tank together and heat the water up for you. We would love to participate in this appeal to God. Again, it's not the baptism that saves you, but it is what saved people do. And if you have turned from your sins and trusted Jesus Christ by faith, you've made that appeal to God. And Scripture commands us to be baptized, because in baptism, you are declaring Jesus's victory over sin and over death and over all that holds us and keeps us away from God. Here in this passage, Peter says that he's seated at the right hand of God. It's the place of power after he's accomplished his mission of what he wanted to do, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring us to God. He's at the right hand of God with angels and authorities and powers being subjected to him. He sits in full authority over everything and over everyone. So Peter's point in this is, even if everything is going sideways, even if it looks like a mess all around you, even if you are experiencing suffering and hardship and persecution and malignment because of Jesus Christ, even if it all looks like a mess, the victory has already been won for you. He already did it. He accomplished it. And those in Christ will join with Jesus Christ in taunting over the authorities and powers of this world, declaring that Jesus has won. He's brought us to God. A beautiful picture it would be for those of us going through a difficult time, experiencing hardships, experiencing suffering, experiencing the training right now. Right now is the time when you and I are running sprints and in the weight room and hard and long practices. We're not experiencing that victory that is our reality just yet. It's been accomplished for us. It's an eternal inheritance that's secure and that's awaiting us in Jesus Christ. We get the participation in his suffering even now. And we will experience the participation of his victory in the future. It's like many of you will take time this summer and take a vacation and spend some time traveling. I hope you get some time away. We're in a number of weeks. I'll be gone on a Sunday because we're going down to Florida to visit some family. And we are driving. It is a 20-hour drive. It's brutal. We do it in one shot, like let the kids sleep and caffeine for me, and we're good. But I'm telling you, it's awful. It is an awful drive. Have you ever driven through Indiana? Like, those windmills are the only thing that's interesting. Like, it's terrible. It is a terrible drive. And then you get to the Florida-Georgia line, and you feel like, oh, man, we're almost there. Nope. See, my family lives in Naples, so it's like, oh, we got another 12 hours. That's what it feels like. It's a through the swamp, it's a terrible drive. It's just like this life. And we go through all of that terrible drive so that I can get to the beach. There is a reward awaiting us. There is an eternal inheritance that's secure for you. It's been accomplished. If you have turned from your sins and trusted in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation, heaven is waiting. Standing face to face with Jesus Christ, it's secure for you. It's done. It's been accomplished. But right now, we're still driving through Indiana a little bit. Right now, you're still in the weight room, and this life is full of suffering and full of heartache and full of persecution. It's full of hardships from the very people who we're trying to save. The very people we're trying to tell about the salvation that they could experience are the ones who are giving us hardship and suffering so often. But that reality of Jesus' victory is waiting for us. Because righteous suffering, it leads to glory. Baptism is an example of that. Noah's Ark is an example of that. And more than anything else, the cross of Jesus Christ is an example. Great suffering to receive such incredible glory for us. It's a beautiful picture that the Lord can take whatever difficulties you and I experience and make something beautiful out of it. You and I will continue to be maligned and persecuted for our faith. We'll continue to be seen as strange, and some will even be antagonistic towards the faith because we follow Jesus. But in the middle of all of that, know that He has already accomplished that victory for you. Suffering, it's not an end of the story, but it is a necessary chapter along the way. And as we await that victory, we do so with hope that we will stand and see Him face to face someday. Father, we are grateful for the victory that You've accomplished for us in Jesus Christ. We recognize each and every day that we are unworthy of it, but we are grateful for Your love and for Your mercy and for Your compassion, how You've reached out to us while we were dead in our trespasses and sins. Christ died for us. We thank You that You have called to each one of us to repent, and we thank You for Your Spirit working so that we could turn from our sins and trust Jesus Christ by faith. Would You allow us, in the middle of the training, in the middle of the difficult days that we experience, allow us to see with new eyes the glory that's awaiting us, the fact that we will be with our Savior who we love so dearly. God, would You come quickly? Bring it soon, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name.